Collect fossils, conduct research, and publish your findings in Holotype Mesozoic North America, a fast-paced worker placement paleontology game from Brexwerx Games, who we have to thank for providing us with a review copy of the game.
So Holotype, I'm just going to call it Holotype for pretty much most of this review, comes from the design team of Brett Harrison and Lex Trenchin, and is the first game published by their own company, Brexwerx Games. Originally published through Kickstarter funding back in 2022 and getting to backers in 2023. You should be able to find this one at your friendly local game stores and most online game stores now.
Holotype, which we're just going to call Holotype going forward, yeah. Plays 2 to 5 players with games taking an hour or two, which is very dependent on the player count. Well, Brexwerx has this one listed as ages 14 plus. We think a younger audience will also dig it, especially because of the dinosaur theme. While it has some meat on it, it's still on the lighter side of worker placement euros, and there are optional rules to make the game even more kid and family friendly. I definitely think this one is good for younger kids.
So in Holotype, players control a team of researchers, which start off as just a paleontologist and their assistant. They're going to use these workers to collect fossils, search for specimens, do research, work with museums, and eventually publish papers, holotypes, on various Mesozoic-era dinosaurs and marine reptiles. After publishing 3 papers, they will attract a grad student, and players will score additional points for completing personal and global objectives.
For a look at the very striking dino artwork and very functional components in this educational game, check out our Holotype unboxing video on YouTube.
The artwork here really is great, as is the card design, the board layout, and the iconography. The custom fossil dice are very well made, and everything in the game is in colorblind-friendly colors. While the overall look may not be as shiny and polished as some modern games, they are very functional, everything just works, and the game also includes a very functional plastic box insert.
So you start Holotype by finding the boards that match your player count, shuffling up all the different decks of cards, and putting them beside the main board. You're going to place the Triceratops marker at the start of the field advancement track. Draw and lay out global objectives equal to the player count minus 1. Everyone grabs a player board of their chosen color and gets an initial hand of 3 specimen cards and 2 personal objectives. They're going to choose one of these objectives to keep.
Players start the game with 2 workers, the paleontologist and assistant. Once a player publishes their 3rd paper, they get the grad student. Each turn, players will place either a single worker out on the board and complete the action for that spot, or collect all of their workers off the board, which earns them 1 research cube. There are a limited number of spots on a board, and a worker can bump a worker of the same level or lower.
In addition, assistants aren't as powerful as the other workers, and they get you less when they're placed. Assistants also can't publish papers.
Now, there's only actually 5 different spots you can choose when playing Holotype, and they're all pretty simple to resolve. You go to the specimen lab to get new specimen cards. You can either draw from the deck or from the discard pile.
You go on field expositions to get fossils by drawing cards, picking 1 site to visit, and then rolling the custom dice to see what fossils you find.
At the university library, you earn research cubes, which are needed to publish holotypes. And at the museum, you can trade fossils for other fossils or for research cubes.
Now, the final spot is for publishing journals. This lets you play a specimen card from your hand by playing the cost of the card in fossils and research. Also, you can add a trace fossil to any non-marine specimen for the cost of 1 additional fossil. This advances the field advancement track.
The field advancement track is the timer for the game. Once a set number of papers are published, the game ends immediately. The game can also end before this if a set number of global objectives are claimed. When moving up on the advancement track, there are spots that reset the museum and milestones. When you hit a milestone, all players get to choose an upgrade.
Each player gets the same set of 6 upgrades at the start of the game and will earn 4 of them by the end of the game. The upgrades do things like letting you hold more fossils, getting you additional research cubes, letting you look at more specimen cards, etc.
In addition to publishing a holotype, players can also use the publishing journal space to claim a global objective. Now, each objective lists a different requirement, and if a player has all of those requirements themselves on the papers they published, this action is free. If instead the objective is only filled through a mix of what yourself and the other players have published, then you have to pay 5 research cubes to cite the other players' papers.
At the end of the game, players score points for all of their published holotypes, their trace fossils played, the number of global objectives they have claimed, and their personal objectives. The player with the most points wins.
If you are interested in playing this with younger kids or just want a more family-friendly experience, the rules include a variant where you remove the personal objectives, you take out the global objectives and the milestones. And there are also rules for both a shorter and a longer game. So there's a lot of variability there.
There's just something about Holotype Mesozoic North America that just works. This game just feels good. It feels balanced and tight, and it flows really well. The mechanics are nothing new, but they work really well, and they tie in well to the theme. The actions you're taking just kind of make sense in regards to researching dinos and publishing papers.
The game's presentation gave me a bit of a pause, as while not amateur, it does have a bit of an educational feel. Now, that said, once the game started, you could tell it was a proper game and not some edutainment thing that had no real development. It's a solid game, and it is well linked to the theme.
I actually like the look and layout of this game, and I love how they made the meeples in various sizes, which just fits in with the rules mechanic and makes it easy and simple to remember.
Yeah, I like the educational feel. Like it's not Genius Games. Genius Games publishes educational games that are like hard education games. I don't know how to describe it. They're more educational. They kind of feel like they're forcing the science on you. Whereas this just kind of gives you the fuel for the work that goes into dinosaur research. And I dig the cute thematic nods, like citing other people's work to publish papers.
Right. It's not in-your-face educational. It just does what it does and presents an educational information along the way in how the characters in the game interact with things and information on the actual holotypes themselves.
Yeah, the game managed to capture the attention of our dinosaur-loving kid just by using proper dino names and eras and non-cartoony artwork. Like, she was really intensely just drawn to it. She's like, wow.
Now, there is one part of the game that might be a little too thematic, and that's the fight to publish and claim the global objectives. Claiming global objectives can get you a ton of points, especially if you claim 5. That is the max amount you can claim in a game. Competition for claiming these can be a big part of the game, but leads to some, like, just weird feeling gameplay. Like paper players being able to publish a holotype, having all the resources, everything they need, but then holding off because they're worried they're just going to give someone else points through them stealing a global objective. Or having a player just, instead of publishing their own papers and holotypes, just hoarding knowledge cubes just to be able to grab global objectives. It just feels off.
In real life, the urgency is to publish before someone steals your thunder with their own paper. So it's kind of a bit of a disconnect rather than holding off in the game. I think of my multiple plays of this game, it does stick out as the most frustrating mechanic in the game.
Okay, I know I'm in the minority here, but I actually sort of like that aspect of the game. I like you're playing chicken and you're holding off on publishing and you're keeping track of what's going on with everyone else at the table. And then you realize, oh, if I jump in and publish right now, then they're not going to have enough cubes to grab that objective first. And I actually like that bit. It's like the next level strategy that only sinks in after you've played the game a few times.
Not a fan of that part myself, but I do love it. The other thematic tie-ins, like looking for fossils, that one in particular, I don't know, something about you randomly grab 2 cards and they're actual fossil sites around the world. And you can read a little fact about them and then you pick which site to go to. And then you're grabbing dice and you got to roll the dice to find out what you get. I like the randomness of that, right? Like it's kind of a Euro game. Otherwise, it's a pure random factor here. And I've been very frustrated when I'm looking for, you know, Jurassic fossils and I keep drawing the wrong eras when I'm going to go for it. But to be fair, like finding fossils is an extremely random experience in real life. And I'm glad they didn't stick too close to the theme, because otherwise most of your digs would give you nothing.
And also, you're not micromanaging dig sites or anything like that. This is a very high level view of the work being accomplished. And thank you for that, because you could really get bogged down in the minutia.
Now, another thing I want to call out is the awesome artwork here. I love the dino artwork on the cards. Like, this is some of the coolest looking dinos I've seen. Now, they did go with the lizard-like non-feathered version of dinos, which is how I grew up imagining them, so it works for me. Personally, though, just the board. The main board just, I don't need some pizzazz. It looks clinical.
Yeah, as I said, the presentation is nice, but that's about all. I think a more experienced publisher would have punched the game's visual design up a level, but it's not suffering. It's just a bit underwhelming, that's all.
Yeah, and I didn't see it. I actually like the board as it's laid out. I find it very functional, and I think it looks nice. So, yeah.
Now, one thing that I do think could be improved here is the iconography. This is mainly with the whole global objective things we were talking about earlier, because you need to be able to look around the table and see what other people have published at a glance. Now, the icons are pretty good, but they just could be better. Another thing that can help with this is how players organize their card. And I now tell everyone to organize their cards by era. But other times I played and said organize them by, you know, other features like carnivore or herbivore. And I honestly wish the rulebook had a detailed, like, here's how to lay out your tableau to help with these things. And I've noticed that there's a fan who has actually created a free global objective tracker on BoardGameGeek, because technically it's not supposed to be secret information. Right? It's not supposed to be your skill at noticing things as part of the game, though, of course, we have played that way.
Yeah, I took a look at that tracker, actually, as part of my research into the ask earlier, and it was utilitarian, I guess, is the best way.
Yeah.
But kind of only barely. It was a bit of a pain, I could imagine, to use, and it took away part of that game that I think D likes, is that making sure that you're very aware of what everyone has done and what is out there and what that next global is going to be the first time someone puts a card down to match that missing thing. What I also noted while I was there is that there are also 104 fan-created yep. dinosaurs available on BoardGameGeek. Oh,
that's cool. As long as they're all real dinosaurs, they didn't start making up...
Someone did was they did the dinosaurs of the world, because this focused on North America. And actually, there'll be expansions coming for Europe monsters officially from Brexwerx. But yeah, the fan stuff on BoardGameGeek is someone went and did not just North America. So you have the world's dinosaurs.
I struggle with the iconography in this one. I have some vision issues, and I really have to, like, from across the table, I'm really struggling to make out what other people have laid out in their tableaus. I wasn't sure if it was just a me problem or an everyone problem. So I feel like if there were just more contrasting colors for the icons, something that you could really see at a glance from across the table, that would just make the game way more playable, at least for me. But I still love it, so.
Deanna just said I still love it, right? This, so far, Holotype Mesozoic North America has been a hit. First played it with the family. Genevieve, our youngest daughter, D called this out already, loves it. She is super enthused by this game and loves reading it. And when we play with her, we have to write out what dinosaur we found and all the stats on the card before you publish your holotype. That's part of the game for her. It's also been a hit with lovely local public play events, playing with gamers of various experience levels. And the one I was surprised by is this managed to win over a local gamer who usually only plays cooperative games and just played this because there was nothing else starting at the time. Now, I think it fits, though, because while the game's competitive, except for that whole global objective sniping thing, it doesn't really feel nasty. Like, it's a worker placement game, but the bumping rules are really forgiving for a worker placement game, and it's very seldom someone takes the thing you want. That doesn't tend to happen in this game.
Yeah, I have to say, I really enjoyed playing this game. It was a solid and perhaps not awe-inspiring game. Again, I'm not a dino fan. I kind of skipped over the dino excitement as a kid. It never really did it for me. But it really plays into its own strengths and ends up being a really solid game to play.
Yeah, I feel like it's just a really great family weight game. That lack of nastiness that Mo mentioned earlier makes it good for, you know, while playing as a family and not getting siblings trying to kill each other. And it's also still a fun game for grownups to play.
So if you're into dinos, or more importantly, maybe your kids are into dinos, you should pick up Holotype. If your kids are younger, just stick to that Basil variant. It's the basic rules. And the nice part there is the game will grow with them, right? You can slowly add in more complexity. I would recommend starting with the milestones so that the game becomes asymmetric as you get playing. And then maybe throw in the personal objectives and maybe leave those global objectives out, only adding them in at the very end. Like, if you really want the family-friendly experience where you're not, there's no backstabbing, just ditch those global objectives.
Yeah, and for educators or classroom game collections, I can definitely see this playing out there. We talked a little bit about the age. It's listed as 14. It can probably go down a little lower, though. And there are those variants available for shorter play, longer play, less competitive play. And so you can really try and capture those kids while they're still in that dinosaur crazed phase. To keep it going and give them a little bit of education along with their game.
Worker placement game fans should also check out Holotype. The neat part here, and it's kind of fascinating that it's this enjoyable, is it's not really doing anything new. I have played many worker placement games where you can bump other people's places if the rules are right. And I play games where you get things for collecting your workers. It actually reminds me a lot of Euphoria, build a better dystopia that way. But there's just something about the flow here you usually don't get with worker placement games. Like, turns are lightning quick. And that's what happened the last time we were playing a public play event. We kept having people saying, oh, it's my turn again, because they weren't expecting it to get back to them so quickly. And I've got to say, there's a nice feeling of accomplishment in this game when you've got that tableau in front of you of all the papers you put out. Like, you feel like you're accomplishing something.
It's got that it's quick, and it's quick to set up, and it's easy to explain, but it's still nice and meaty.
And because of that, you know what? Just try Holotype if you can. Like, I think this is going to appeal to a fairly broad range of gamers. There's a lot here to like, and there's not a lot I think that'll turn people off. What I worry is people are going to dismiss it as a kid's game because it's about dinosaurs and marine reptiles. This is not just a kid's game, though I do think it would work with kids.
Well, that brings us to the end of our research paper on Holotype. I hope we've covered everything you want to know about this new-to-us game discovery. What did you learn today? Let us know in the comments below, or better yet, cite our work by sharing this review with your fellow gamers.
Game research and review can be a lot of work. Do you know what helps us get through the day? Coffee! Buy us a coffee at ko-fi.com/tabletopbellhop to keep us both caffeinated and motivated.